I am George Diebold. That's okay. It looks like Diebold. It's called Concentrate on the Image. Before I get started, thank you so much to everyone here at B&H for allowing me to come in and do this. And of course, the great Mel DiGiacomo for introducing me to these fine people. I'm going to talk for about 2 or 3 minutes. Just stay with me before you actually see the first picture. So for those of you who are not familiar with me or my images, this will you'll get an idea of where I came from in my artistic and professional career. Despite having an atrocious academic experience in high school, my art teacher took mercy on me and actually introduced me to a famous Life magazine illustrator. So I studied with him, learning what he referred to as the theory of light. All we used to do is just set up still lifes with a single light source on them and just look at how light would fall on things, soft light, harsh light. And he also instructed me in the old school Renaissance style of oil painting, which was with an egg emulsion underpainting. So before you would actually paint on the canvas, there was a whole nother painting, a charcoal drawing and a painting underneath the painting, which was all done with egg emulsion to highlight all the different things, all the different light highlights. So it all tied in with what he was teaching me. So I went away to college as a fine art major. I actually had a little cottage business going in my dorm room doing portraits of rock stars, where people would come to my dorm room and purchase oil paintings from me. And one night, sitting in the library, in the space of about 10 seconds, I just said to myself, what am I doing being a painter? How could you possibly make a living being a painter? I'm going to be a photographer. I went home for the Christmas break, got a job in a factory, saved up enough money, and bought a knicker mat, and went back to college as a photographer, or at least I thought I was a photographer. I graduated with 2 degrees, photography and fine art, which really did absolutely nothing. It took me about a year to get a job in a big production house pushing a broom. I went from there to Bambergers, which was the New Jersey division of Macy's. And within about a year and a half after that, I opened my first studio. So, now, enough of that. This is, I selected this picture. It's really the first picture that I did which made me money, which was commercially successful for me. I shot it in my living room on a light box that I constructed. I took it to a fine art company, and they made it into big, huge display prints, and it earned me about $300 a month for 2 years, which doesn't sound like a lot, but at the time my rent was $175 a month. So that was this was a big home run. I built my career over the next couple of years doing large format product still life, studio still life work, working for AT&T, Sony, Bell Labs, most of the pharmaceutical companies in New Jersey. I was very lucky because even though the place everybody, you know, assumes the place to be was in New York, most of the world headquarters for all these places were in New Jersey. So I had a big advantage there. I developed a reputation for doing a lot of this ethereal kind of lighting. Because of my training at Macy's, I had learned how to work with tungsten lighting, but I also would mix tungsten with strobe. I would use flashlights. This is a picture done with about 20 flashlights. I would use lasers. I would shoot lights through liquids to refract the light, give different effects. I also had a good relationship with a lot of model makers, and this would be an example of two acrylic heads, which my model maker carved out. This is done with in-camera masking. This is obviously way before Photoshop, way before personal computing. One head is shot, and then there's another setup where the other head is. I shot 35 millimeter slides specifically for this of these patterns which I created, and then those slides were taken and put in a projector and projected through the back of the acrylic heads. That's how I got this effect. I also had a good following of people who liked these montages I did, these in-camera montages. Today, something like this is a 3-minute picture, but back in the day, this was in my studio. I would have three, for this one, for instance, I would have three different view cameras set up, one pointing at the test tube, one pointing at a still life of the stethoscope, and one pointing at the EKG pages. It would shoot the test tube, take the film holder out of the camera, put it in the next camera, which was the stethoscope, take that out, move it to the third one, shoot that. One of my assistants would drive it to the lab, kill 2.5 hours, drive back to the studio, we'd look at it on the light box, and we would say, oh, you know what, the stethoscope is 1/2 inch lower than I wanted it to be. Move the stethoscope up or crank the camera up, reshoot it, assistant would drive back to the lab. 2.5 hours later, he'd come back and say, oh my God, you know what, the EKG pages are too bright over here. So a lot of times when you tell somebody, like that guitar shot that I did, the second picture that was up here, when you say, you know, I spent 4 or 5 days on a picture, and somebody would say, like, you know, what were you doing? But that was not unusual, especially with the kind of still life stuff I was doing. Also, because I kind of grew up in my dad's machine shop, I was very mechanically inclined, and I was, again, this is all before personal computing and Photoshop and everything, so I used to build a lot of my own props. Here I constructed this huge maze out of foam core, found a printer in a print shop who had a color printer who, why he did this, I don't know, but he made me like 200 copies of $100 bills. I'm sure that's very legal. And I glued them on. And this picture, you can tell the bills are different now, but these were the changeover from the very, very old style. This picture is probably 20 years old, and this probably made me money for 20 years. So it was a very popular image. Here would be an example of a model that my model maker made. He did this incredible ant about this big. I took one of these construction sonotubes, which they make the concrete pilings out of. I got a 5-gallon vat of Elmer's glue, and I tumbled the glue in the sonotube. Then I filled the sonotube with dirt, rolled that so all the dirt stuck to the edge of the pipe. And this is what it looks like if you're an ant and you're going out into the world in the morning. I also was a big fan of having my model makers make me miniature people, or using miniature people from train sets that you get in a hobby shop. I sort of got into this because I would spend so much time on a picture, and these models would never complain. You would never need a model release from them. They wouldn't come back and sue you years later, and you could spend all night, you know, moving them around. And they're very, very easy to work with. So, again, as all this new technology started to come out with, you know, in the 90s and computing and everything like that, my style of shooting fit in very well with that, because there was so many companies that were doing things, not necessarily making things anymore. They were doing things, and they had to have some way to say something, but they didn't really know how to say it. So it was perfect, because I would go in, my portfolio was very different than most photographers had at the time in New Jersey. It was a lot of times, you know, you could look at my portfolio and said, why would we possibly hire him? I mean, it doesn't even look like he shoots normal stuff. But for somebody who had a product that they were trying to say something and they didn't quite know how to say it, I had all these dreamy kind of images like this, and so it worked out very well. This I is a particular favorite of mine. It's called American Baby. I was getting my hair cut one time, and I looked in the mirror at the girl cutting my hair, and I couldn't resist. I said to her, I've never seen a mouth like yours. I said, would you come to my studio? And just, I want you to make impressions on the little napkins. I didn't really know what I wanted to do, but I knew I could think of something to do with it. And again, this was right around the time when computing was, you know, starting to really explode. And everybody was talking about this thing called the binary code. So I did a little still life here of, you know, like a pickup or exchanging phone numbers in a bar with ones and zeros. Later on, maybe about 6 months later, I was working on an annual report for AT&T. And I had, my studio was just filled with all kinds of, you know, the peripherals, that wires and cables and headsets and everything they make. And I thought of her again, and I asked her to come back to the studio. And I did this picture with her. So this is still all straight photography. This is pre, well, at least for me, it was pre-Photoshop. In those days, you could never shoot enough fiber optic pictures. This, again, is lit using the fiber optics, but also lit with flashlights, projectors, strobe. So there's about four different blended light sources here. I had saltwater aquariums, and in those aquariums, I had lionfish, and I found myself about every 4 days coming home from the fish store, where I would have to buy like a dozen goldfish to, unfortunately for them, feed the lionfish. And I was driving home one day, and I was looking at the bag sitting on my seat next to me, and I had remembered this statement that I had heard when, like in advertising, when they talk about captive audience, when you're trying to, like a focus group or something like that. So that's what these guys are, captive audience. And they're no longer with us. I also, at around this time, started taking a number of trips a year around the country, just driving on these big, long, extended odysseys, where I would, usually what I do is I fly to Las Vegas, I pick up a rental van, and I have all kinds of props. Sometimes I'll have as many as 25 hotels booked ahead. And I will often ship props to different hotels, so they're waiting there for me when I get to the different locations. But I also travel with all kinds of stuff in the car, just in case I got some kind of idea, and I would, you know, be ready to do it. And this was a mushroom that my model maker made, and I think I was in the Pacific Northwest. I mean, it certainly looks like it. And I said, oh, this would be a perfect place for this mushroom. I don't consider this one of my great pictures, but I this is a funny story. This is another pre-Photoshop kind of story. I happened to have these highway cones in the van with me when I was driving around. I came upon this lava field where this lone tree was growing. And I thought, oh, I'll make it like, you know, Mother Earth and save everybody and save the trees and all that. And so I shot this with a 300 millimeter lens, so I was back about 150 yards away. And so I went and I arranged the cones, and I don't know if you've ever walked across a lava field, but it's you don't skip across it. Every rock you step on, you like fall down and cut yourself. So I go back and look in the camera and be like, ugh. The one on the left has to go over like 18 inches. So like I go all the way back over and like move that, and then go back and look in the camera and say, oh, now that I moved that, now it makes the one on the right look stupid. And so, you know, I guess what I'm trying to show you with these pictures is it was a lot harder to take pictures. And I think for me, that was better because it was more time spent concentrating on the picture. So, okay, here's a watershed picture in my life, and here's the story with this one. This again was an in-camera montage of the globe and the keyboard. This is again, today you would just say, like, I want to put information on the key, just go into Photoshop, but this is actually type that I rub down on the keyboard, and I put this word information. So every summer, my wife and my son and I would go, I would take off for like between 4 and 6 weeks and travel around the Hawaiian Islands surfing and scuba diving. And I was sitting on the lanai, that's a patio, one morning, and I beeped in to my answering machine, not with my email, for my messages. And there was a message from, I believe it was Pacific Power and Light. And they said, we saw this picture and three companion pictures, and we'd like to buy the one-time rights for them to use in an ad for $4,000 a picture, so $16,000. So later on that day, with the time change, I got my assistant on the phone, told him to go to the studio, pack the chromes up, and send them to the client. But I remember walking into the living room at the condo I was staying at, and I said to my wife, I just made 16 grand sitting here in a bathing suit. And I said, we can live this life if we want to. And so it was within about a year of this that I went from, even though I kept shooting still life work and doing large format work, I went from doing this kind of stuff to living like this, shooting this kind of stuff. I bought a home in Hawaii, pretty much demolished it and rebuilt the whole thing, redesigned the home and rebuilt the home. And that was a very big change for just, you know, my entire lifestyle. And I built a studio in the home out there. So when I still kept the studio back in Montclair, New Jersey, and I could go back and forth. And so here's the first question. I'm allowed to ask questions, even though you guys aren't. What do these two images have in common? This is a little bit of a trick question, but okay. I'll take a sip of water while everybody's thinking about this. That's a good answer. It's not that complicated. They're both done by somebody who's having fun being a photographer. I'm not trying to save the world. I'm not a war correspondent. I enjoy taking pictures, and I've been lucky that it's worked out for me. The one on the right was done at the Village Halloween parade, and the one on the left was done at the Bonneville Salt Flats, where I happened to just be in a hardware store, and I saw this pool, this blow-up pool float, and I actually left that a word in the title. It's actually called rare desert clownfish. So I took this blow-up clownfish out into the salt flats, and I photographed it out there where you had this very strong reflection. Right behind me, about 200 yards behind me, is Route 80. And I remember when I was shooting this, everybody that went by honked and was waving at me. And I remember thinking to myself, you know what? I'm very lucky because I'm out here on the Bonneville Salt Flats with a blow-up clownfish taking a picture that I will most likely eventually someday sell for a lot of money. So these little notes are, for some reason, PowerPoint just took this and rearranged it. But these little notes are as much for you as they are for me. So these help me remember where I'm at and help me keep my thoughts together here. About 5 years ago, I was just playing around with photographing matches, extinguishing them, and using a super, super high-speed flash to freeze the smoke. I was backlighting the smoke. One of my college buddies saw the picture, and he said, oh, yeah, he goes, I see the bird. And I was just like, you know, oh yeah, I guess so. I guess you could say, you know, there's a bird. And then somebody else sent me a letter and said, oh, I see a chariot. I see that picture you did. Is it called Chariot? And I was just like, so I started to think about that. And 3 or 4 years passed by, and I revisited this idea. I said, I'm going to get a matchbox, and I'm going to make a template to hold them consistently the same way over and over again. And I got myself a couple dozen boxes, so a couple hundred matchbooks. And I started shooting matchbooks, just looking for the hidden characters in the matchbooks. And this was the first one that really popped out to me. This is called Veiled Woman and Woodpecker. This is, again, same technique, just backlit with the strobe. It's probably 50 to 1 as far as how many matchbooks I would shoot versus when I would see something. Obviously, this is the veiled woman, and she's holding the woodpecker. You have to have a little bit of imagination for this, but you're supposed to have an imagination because you're here. This one just reminded me of when you see those distant, like the Hubble telescope pictures where the galaxies far, far away, you know, you see the smoke, that almost resembles smoke. This was another one which I thought jumped right out of me. It's called Darth Vader Looking at Skull. My wife was reading that the book that came out a couple years ago, 50 Shades of Grey. Yeah, I didn't read it. But when I saw this, I immediately said to myself, God, look how many different colors of smoke are in there. So I just called it 50 Shades of Smoke. This was another one that just jumped right off the page to me. It's called Madonna and Child. And again, this is just, you know, I would try different techniques, but they're not Photoshop. They're just all a lot of matches. It's just really what it comes down to. I had a little device that held them exactly the same way every time. I would light them. The minute I would light them, I wouldn't blow on them because that would disperse the smoke too much. But I had all sorts of different techniques I was using with different cups and things that shot the air down at them so it would immediately extinguish them and just start. And then I would put the camera on, you know, on the fast setting, the motor drive setting, and I would maybe get 10 to 15 shots per matchbook. And embryonic creature exhaling blue smoke. Here's the embryonic creature. There's his eye. And here he is, the blue smoke. This one, I did use Photoshop in this. The picture is half of this. This is called Crab Nebula, and I duped it, flipped it, and butted it together, and out of nowhere, this thing appeared. So not only does it look like, you know, some outer space galaxy far away, but you got this lobster crab thing in the center there that just happened to appear. So I thought that was incredible. This is now there's about another year has passed. I just have started to revisit it again, and I just threw this in just because I like it. There's no characters in it. I just like the way the smoke was moving. I don't know exactly when I got the idea to do this, but obviously I was getting my car washed, and I gave the attendant there some money, and I said, would you mind if I just went through the car wash continuously, like 20 times in a row, but stayed in the car? And which he was just like, you know, you obviously have a problem, but sure. So I set the ISO extremely high. And I would just sit on the seat and just brace myself as best I could. and shoot the wipe, the brushes hitting the window. I'm surprised I didn't wear the paint off my car. I mean, so, and then whenever I was on the road and I would see a good car wash, one that had, I was always looking for skylights. Well, this was actually a tremendous find, because if you go to car washes, I bet you've never seen red brushes. And when I saw this, I was just like, wow, because they're always this. And then, you know, when they put all that ridiculous wax on, and they tell you, you know, like the another $6 for all the stuff, and it just drips down on the side. And so when they saw, after a while, when they saw what I was doing, they were just like squirting so much stuff on the car. And everything. Again, I mean, I can't remember how high I had the ISO set, but really high, like, I don't know, 6,000 or something like that. And then I was using, I think a lot of these I used, there was a Nikkor lens that was, it's a 50 millimeter 1.2. So it was allowing me to get like a really high shutter speed, whatever the highest is on the camera. And it was freezing it really easily. And that's as you're leaving. Okay, so after Hurricane Sandy, my wife and I were down at the seaside boardwalk trying to do good and eat food and clams and everything and spread our money around. And I noticed that there was a candy fudge shop there that as the sun would start to set, the light would skim across the boardwalk and just burn a hole into the front of this store. And the way they got around it was they would drop this big yellow tarp down in front of the store. I noticed that between the tarp and the candy display case, there was about 3 feet of room. And when you looked behind it, you saw all the shadows of the people walking by. The thing I thought was incredible about this, or I didn't think this at the time, but as I started to, I returned over a period of 3 weeks. I asked the owners, you know, could I just sit on the floor here and just continuously shoot? This is another example of just hundreds and hundreds of shots. The thing that I, for me, was the most fascinating about this was that these people don't exist in the real world, as far as, they're not friends or acquaintances in the real world, but in the shadow world, now they become a picture. These three look like they're goofing on this man, or, you know, or they're about to jump him or something, but they have nothing to do with him. He's just minding his own business, walking along, and these three fools are just behind him, like, you know, being teenagers on the boardwalk. And whenever somebody would happen to see my feed or see me and look behind and they would clown and jump around and stuff like that, I would be like, yeah, yeah, and I would take their picture and everything. And then as soon as they would walk away, I would just delete all the pictures. I didn't save any pictures of anybody who knew what I was doing. These are just all people. This is a guy's walking down the boardwalk stretching. Here, there's probably three sets of people. There's a mom. And a kid, and then these two, and then this guy is completely separate over here. There's the name of the place, Berkeley Sweet Shop. I left it backwards just because I thought if I went and flipped it so you could read it easily, I just thought it detracted from the picture, so I just left it just the way it looked. Sadly, probably within 5 days of me finishing doing this series, the place next door to this business was where the Seaside Heights fire started. So, and even sadder, especially for somebody like me who's mechanically minded, they had a what was called a taffy making machine. There's only two in existence, and it was lost in the fire. It was a gigantic device that like stretched taffy and then yanked the taffy into pieces and then wrapped it, and it was so complicated it looked like, you know, something that was made the space shuttle, but it was just for making taffy. But so this is all gone. This is completely obliterated. Very sad. So here's a profound thought. I'm sure I'm not the first person who's mentioned this to you. This is something that you should do. I remember once hearing that Keith Richards keeps a notebook and a pen on his bedside table, and he woke up in the middle of the night one night, and he just went like, dun, 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 and he wrote down the notes, and then he just went back to bed, and when he woke up in the morning, that was satisfaction. So there is something to be said for writing down your thoughts, because your thoughts do just pop out of your head. When Fortunoffs went out of business over in New Jersey, I made a mental note to go back over there sometime when there was an ice storm or a snowstorm or something inclement, because I knew they wouldn't be plowing the mall anymore, obviously. They wouldn't be plowing the mall for a bankrupt business. I did. I went over at about 3 o'clock in the morning during an ice storm. Then I got this very serene looking picture, which was picked up by the Cleveland Museum of Art, so that's in their permanent collection. Traveling up the parkway one night, I was just amazed at just the serenity of this, the toll booth. It's just devoid of people. Even here where it says cash receipts, you can just go through those at 100 miles an hour. I mean, at 2 o'clock in the morning, there's nobody standing out on the guards. They probably, don't quote me on that. But I also, I saw this store in a town near me, and I knew that when there was a snowstorm, I knew that all this tremendous fluorescent light coming off the building underneath us is just like, crummy parking lot and everything. But I knew when I had a nice pristine white palette to work with that all this light coming off the fluorescent lights would tint this snow in this really beautiful look like this. I'm sure a lot of you have shot this. I wanted to somehow convey lost souls, the people, that were lost, just the loneliness and the complete, the ghostliness of what happened. So I found this observation point over on the Jersey side. I think it was in front of some hotel. I can't remember what hotel, but it's about 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning. They're just starting to get a little bit of a glow in the back. What's funny about this picture to me is this is probably a 45 second or a minute exposure. When I opened the shutter, the pigeon landed, and he's not dead sharp, but he's about as sharp as it could possibly be. He's just remained absolutely motionless for the entire exposure. And I just did the one exposure, and not to get too ethereal or anything like that, but it's almost just like, like a spirit landed and just said, I'm here to represent all the people. So same situation. I was shooting, the tower is still under construction, and there was, at that hour in the morning, especially with an extremely long exposure, the river is really very calm, and it was a very strong reflection. Obviously not this strong. I took this back to the studio, duped it, flipped it, and then I gave a little bit of a motion effect on the bottom half of it just to enhance the look of it. This is the big challenge in photography, seeing something in a new way, because especially nowadays, there was a time when I was really very heavily involved in stock photography that if you went on, say, Corbis's website and you typed in globe, probably 70% of the images were mine. So just because, A, I knew to shoot globes because that was something that people would always be buying. Now, if you type in globe, you probably get 350,000 returns, and if you type it in next Monday, you'll probably get 380,000 returns. So it's trying to find something to shoot and trying to find a new way to shoot it is not easy. I just had a show which was sponsored by Dugal called Saltwater at the Green Square Tavern here in town, and these are some of my saltwater pictures. This is shot out in Hawaii. It's actually, the wave came in and now it's pulling out. And it's like maybe a 20th of a second or something exposure. And so it's dragging all the sand back out with it. This is probably one of my most successful pictures ever from a financial standpoint, not in stock. Throughout my entire career, I've been holding back pictures, and really now my business is really focused more on just people buying my prints for collecting my prints or buying interior designers buying the prints. So this is sort of a this was just a picture that was never really used for stock. It was just done for fine art. This, I just sold one of these in Miami to a big corporation, an 8-foot print. And then about 2 weeks ago, a designer working on a home on the Big Island of Hawaii bought one of these, again, like 8.5 feet long. This, again, is the sun is setting behind it. But it's that time of day when has very, very small window and the light is coming through the wave, but it's not giving it that yellowish, goldish look that you get like at the complete end of the day, like that sunset kind of pictures. I'm just taking advantage of the light hitting it this way. Again, this is dragging out the exposure and just getting the effect of all the sand being moved around. This is done on the Big Island of Hawaii. I'm sure you've heard that there's the lava beaches there. These are not very pleasant beaches to swim in. Amazingly enough, this is a color picture. This is not a black and white picture. And the sand is so, it's if you walked in here, you'd probably end up with a broken ankle. There's all kinds of like little chunks of lava and everything tumbling around in there. But when the wave pulls back, it leaves this absolutely flawless pattern. It almost looks like linoleum. Really a great place to shoot. There's also beaches on the Big Island that are green. I mean, green sand. And when I say green, I mean, it's actually like green sand. It's really something. They also have red sand beaches. There's a tidal pool. The tide is going out. And it almost looks like lunar craters where the water is drifting down. Again, I'm dragging out the exposure here, probably like a 3 or 4 second exposure. This, when I saw this block of concrete, which was covered with algae underwater in Honolulu, I said, I gotta be able to do something with this. I don't know what I can do with it. And I stood there long enough to see that the waves would come in from all three sides, and they would hit in the center of this block right here and create this effect. So after experimenting with all sorts of different shutter speeds, I finally settled on one, which is probably like a 30th of a second or something, and did a, it's called Ghost Image on Jetty. I have some that look just like horses, but I thought it was just a very tranquil looking picture. Again, just trying to shoot the ocean in a different way. Here's a little sandbar by my house, which I think this is technically, it's called an isthmus. It's like when a ribbon of sand connects a little offshore island. So when the tide is coming in, the two waves come in from each side, they hit in the center, and they create this ribbon. This is done after the sun has gone down, so there's, you can see there's really no strong directional light. Here it is right before the sun went down, and you can see it started back here and it's just progressing down like this. It's almost like a zipper that's being pulled closed. Same spot, but this is where the storm approaching. So there's a very heavy blue cast to the clouds above. This is shot in the morning, but again, almost no direct light on it, just maybe a little bit of light like hitting on this edge. But the same effect happening where it's closing up like a zipper. This I just did about a month and a half ago out on the Pacific Coast Highway. If you're a surfer, everybody's always talking about getting in the green room. And so that's the title of this, the green room, where you're inside the wave. This is another sad New Jersey story. I just happened to go down to the shore and shoot the Ocean Grove fishing pier. And then like 5 days later, Sandy came. So there is no more Ocean Grove fishing pier, or there's a couple piers left standing, but this is it. Planted the camera, dug it down into the sand on a tripod, obviously, and just using a 15 millimeter lens. So it's I'm very close to the, I mean, I'm right here in front of this thing. Just did all kinds of variations of the water coming and going. This I thought resembled some kind of skeleton from a shore, from a whale or something on the beach. This was the tides going out and it's dragging the sand with it. And this is again, last couple minutes right before the sun goes down and it's skimming across it, across the sand and the little puddles of water left behind. This I was going up the Pacific Northwest coast. I've always heard of, you know, sea foam when you go down the shore and you see the foam on the edge of the waves breaking. This I would assume is due to all the giant redwoods and everything that get washed out into the ocean, and the sap and tannins and all that stuff break down in the water and creates this sea foam that this was literally as thick as latex paint. And it was coming into this little cove, and as it came into the cove, it would compress the air and the air would blow back and hit this. And since it's done pretty much in the middle of the day, even though it's raining, I was able to use an extremely high shutter speed, and it froze it, so it's got that, I mean, you know, this almost looks like elephant skin down here, and that was I thought, very unusual. I'd never seen anything like that. So, creating a picture versus discovering a picture. Here is a flexible dryer vent with men in it. So this would be creating a picture. This would be walking down the street in Las Vegas. As the sun is starting to set, it's coming through the back of this fountain. The marquees and everything from the hotels are so overwhelming out there that as the sun starts to get weak, the marquees are almost creating as much light as the sun was. So in this area, this is the last bit of sun blasting through, but over here where there's these crazy colors, that's all the marquees that are on the strip coming through the back. And this is with that amount of light, it's allowing me to shoot extremely high shutter speed and freezing all of this stuff, which if you looked at it close up, it's almost becoming like an acrylic sculpture. This is very impressive big. Somebody bought one of these from me, 78 inches across, so you can really see every little detail in it. Creating a picture, here's a series I did working in the studio with dry ice. Discovering a picture, dramatically different. Creating a picture of gum, foil gum pack. Sitting, waiting to do another shot. I just shot out the window. I think the one thing I'd like you to take away from when you look at, I know I'm jumping all over the place. I mean, you'll be able to trace my career from starting out doing large format work, and now I'm drifting into doing more environmental work. But just shooting, you could say for the fun of it, but you know, when you have an idea about something, or you should be keeping that logbook and writing down things that you know, you want to shoot, and doing them. This would be a combination of creating and discovering, because I was out in the white sand dunes discovering, and in Walmart I found this ridiculous thing to hold toilet paper. So I said, I'm going to take this out into the sand dunes, and it made me think of when you say be prepared. So, I don't have the picture here, but one other time, I always think to myself when I leave a hotel room, what the housekeepers must think, because I leave stuff behind. They must just wonder what in God's name was going on here. I did another picture right after this with a, you can buy those steer heads with the horns, you know, when you're out west. And I had that, and then I had a Tupperware container, a big filled with ping pong balls and like, you know, tennis balls and highway cones and everything. So I left that and the steer head on the bed. And, you know, I'm just surprised sometimes I don't get letters from, you know, Marriott or somebody. When there's nothing to shoot, be prepared to make pictures. There's only a couple of these, but this is a very studio looking picture. And this is actually shot outdoors. When I'm traveling, I always travel with a folder filled with different backgrounds, primarily white and black, but a lot of different colored backgrounds. It was pouring rain. I was up in Nova Scotia. I wasn't getting anything done. It was a complete waste of time. I saw a rest area with a picnic bench with a cover over it. And I went in and I set myself up a little still life setup underneath the cover to get out of the rain. And I just went around and I picked dandelions and brought them back and shot them right there on the side of the road. So it's a very, very studio looking shot, but actually done just out of desperation. Had a situation one March in Hawaii. This would be good advice, even though it would seem like, of course, when do you want to go to Hawaii? That would be in the winter. It can be a little iffy. And we actually had one March when we were living out there. We had 42 days of rain. And it's Hawaii rain. It's the kind of rain that when it's raining and you're inside, you really can't even talk. That's how loud it is. So I really had, you know, there was, even if I wanted to do like inclement weather pictures and go outside and shoot that kind of stuff, I would have needed an underwater housing. I mean, it's really like the fire department is holding the hose on your house, and it's just. So I went to the pet store and I bought all these betta fish, which was another story, because when I bought like, I don't know, $200 worth of betta fish, and when I was done shooting, I went back to the pet shop, and as soon as the woman saw me come in, she was just like, "You can't return them! You can't return them!" And I told her, "You can have them back." I said, "I don't want my money. You can have them back." So she was, of course, she was all in favor of that. You know, no problem there. But I shot these guys. And then when you're inside for 42 days, your mind starts to wander. And I said, put a 15 millimeter lens down inside a cheese grater. I was watching some movie movie channel, and they talked about some movie, and they said a screwball comedy. So I said, I went and got a styrofoam ball, and I just went to Home Depot and got every conceivable screw I could get. And, another fine example of when my son's friends used to see me when they would come to the studio working, they would be like, "Mr. Diebold, what do you do?" You know. So this is, I guess you would call this sort of like street photography, but just being in different locations and just looking for the pictures that exist around me. Not trying to think in terms of getting back to the studio and put them together or anything, just really trying to find unusual pictures. This is one of those giant skywalks that goes over the Vegas Strip, the glass, so people can get from one side of the strip to the other without being hit by a car. So I set my camera up on a tripod with a very powerful lens so I could be parallel with him. Some other place, I forget where I was, up on a balcony or something like that. So all the lines were straight. The guy's walking along playing a saxophone, commuting to work. I felt sorry for these guys. I mean, I don't know what would be the possible situation where there would be the, you know, what they could be doing manually, because this could take 100 years. I mean, when you're in Honolulu, everybody goes to the ABC store and buys a raft to float around on and ride the waves, and every raft is either green or pink. And they built this concrete wall to make this little safe area in here so the people walk out on the concrete wall and get battered by the waves and stuff. So this is, the sun is just scorching across the surface of the water and backlighting these rafts. Now, here's the kind of picture, you don't get many of these opportunities in your lifetime. Bronze turtle confronted by stone lion. I was set up across the street taking a picture of all of this, which I thought looked really cool. And there's a lion here and a lion there. And as I'm shooting it, I look down the street and I see a truck, delivery truck is unloading, and these two guys are taking this turtle off and putting him on this pallet mover. This is in San Francisco, you can tell the street is... And I look this way, and I look at what I'm shooting, and I said, you know what's going to happen? I said, these guys are coming up the street, and in about a minute and a half, this lion, which, I mean, if you look at the lion, he's like staring right at the turtle, and the turtle is staring right at him. So this is a pretty rare occurrence. It doesn't necessarily look like something I would shoot all the time, but... pretty hard to pass up an opportunity like that, and it rarely ever happens. But so here I am taking pictures of this abandoned house in the redwood forest with a couch out back, and I hear something behind me, and I turn around, and there's an elk about 50 feet behind me. And he is not paying any attention to me. He's just eating, and he's taking one step at a time about every 15 or 20 seconds. And I'm looking at him, and I'm looking at this, and I say to myself, if I stand here for however long it takes, and it ended up being about 40 minutes, I said, he's going to just come right like this, and he's going to end up standing right next to the couch. And he did, and that's why he's a white trash elk. And this is in the Montclair Art Museum, in their permanent landscape collection. So that, I mean, there would be no point in me, believe me, it's an actual scene. Why would anybody think this up and create it in Photoshop? It was. This is from the Holi Festival. where everybody throws powder on themselves. This is not the best idea for your camera. Because when you try to tell people, just be respectful of my camera, okay? And that's almost like telling somebody, see how much powder you can throw on my camera. So you have to like cover it in some kind of bag or something. Again, in San Francisco, I was shooting this green wall, and then I started to see the way people were walking past it, and I said, you know what, I'm just going to photograph the way people are changing the way they walk. Now, you would think if you lived in San Francisco, you wouldn't, this is not what you would choose to wear. And you look at her calves, and you look at her knuckles. I mean, she is so stressed out walking. As opposed to this guy, who's just floating along. How you do this, I don't know. That's talent. A typical scene in any American city. This is the Halloween parade. Somebody actually, it's just to show you the level that people, the creativity that people have. Somebody, there was a Michael Jackson impersonator, and he actually had like 20 zombies, and he was recreating, they were recreating the Thriller video walking down the street. And this is one of the zombies, and I caught her just right. This is a very lucky moment. I was again shooting in San Francisco. This guy came out of a hair salon. He was one of the stylists, I guess. Came out to check his phone and have a smoke. And when he sat down in this alleyway, you know, sometimes you see like the papers blown around and everything like this, and it was blowing his hair like this. I got off a couple shots, and he got up to leave, and I ran across the street, and I said, I don't want to encourage smoking or, you know, ruining your health or anything. I said, could you just keep smoking, have a couple more cigarettes? Because I said, this is such an incredible picture that's happening. I said, I have to make sure that I get it. So he was like, oh, you know, that's great, fantastic. So he was very agreeable. He let me shoot him for another two or three cigarettes so I could get the right hair. This is one of the portfolios that you'll see on my website. Just combing the streets all hours of the night, driving during winter storms, driving around the industrial areas of New Jersey, just photographing whatever I find. This was a really amazing scene that I just found about 4 weeks ago. I was out in California shooting landscapes, and I went to change directions on the highway. When I came underneath the underpass, this sewer grate was just happened to be the exact right time of day. This light was coming down through the sewer grate and making this pattern on the wall and the ground in the underpass. I thought that was a very fortunate situation. And it, again, you know, once the angle of the sun changed, because I drove through it, you know, maybe an hour later, and it was just black and just wasn't there. There's a deli awning shooting up through it from behind, where another sign, the reflection of another sign, is bouncing onto the back of the awning. And then for some reason, somebody took the H here and cut it out with a razor blade. I don't know why that was, but that was a very graphic looking picture. Another industrial scene in New Jersey. This is at Wendover Airport out in Utah. This is where they practiced taking off the planes for the raid on Hiroshima. But and this is all that's left of this one building is this chimney, and that plane happened to be parked there. I thought this was very Pink Floyd looking. Looked like a Pink Floyd cover. again, shooting in Vegas, somebody got the idea to try to salvage all these great signs and neon and everything and hold them until they can get the money. And one by one, they're restoring them. So they have all these signs in a pen. And little by, as they get the money, they redo one, and then they bring it to the Vegas downtown area, and they relight it and remount it. And so this is the holding pen where the ones that are waiting to be done are kept. A little social commentary there. Another business that went under. This was just leaving a town one morning in New Mexico, just pulled over. The funny story about this was the gas station attendant was standing out here, and I went and I told him to get down behind the counter, which I'm sure at, 4 o'clock in the morning was a little disturbing to him. But I explained to him that I didn't want anybody in the picture and he was disrupting the composition. So he understood that. And I shot this, and this got picked up by also the Cleveland Museum of Art and I think the Mesa Contemporary Museum out in Phoenix. Lonely gas station. This, I thought, was a funny way to solve the problem of sealing up a wall or an underpass. This is the effect of sodium lighting in a parking lot with a very heavy fog, and it's tinting in this very bizarre way. It's just a quick, the bus stopped at exactly the right spot where, I think this is Times Square, there's a big American flag lit up, bounced off the bus, made this nice composition. Everybody shoots this, the Transamerica building when they go to San Francisco, so I figured, let me see if I can come up with some unique way to shoot the Transamerica building. I was in Chinatown, so I positioned myself, found a spot where I could find the reflection of the building, but also see a street, and then also people sitting, having lunch on the street, but also the inside of this shop that sold all these lanterns. So this is all one picture, but it's just like three levels deep of reflection. This was on my, if you ever hear this line from Bob Dylan, this was on my diploma in college. When I heard this, it really struck me and it stayed with me for, I'm showing it to you now, so I guess it stayed with me all that time. And for me, that means probably about 4 times a year, I'll take off on a road trip. I'll just go, like I said before, usually fly into Vegas, pick up a rental van, have hotels booked all over the West, and just drive phenomenal amounts of mileage, shooting constantly. All I do, I don't go with anybody, I don't go with an assistant, my wife, nobody, I just shoot. If I see something and it interrupts what I'm doing, I just stay and I do that. If I go back to the hotel at the end of the night and I clean up and I'm going to dinner, and on the way to dinner, I see something, I don't eat dinner, I just stay and I shoot. So that's why you gotta do it alone. Nobody would put up with that. The advantage is that, every morning you're waking up and it's just a new, fresh new view of a new place and new things to see. The phone's not ringing, I'm not at the studio, there's nothing to do except just do this. This I did last year. This is a really beautiful region of the eastern side of Washington State, the Palouse. So it's actually, it's a wheat growing region, but I think it's actually bigger than like Nebraska and Kansas. Very, very dramatic lighting. This was cloud, just a little opening in the cloud. Boom, happened. And over. I shot this two different ways, one in this version like this, And then here in a panoramic, I did this by stitching. In other words, I had one of these tripod heads that would manually, you know, take like 12 shots and then put them together. Same region. This is the Olympic National Park. Great place to shoot. I remember almost killing myself trying to pull off the road fast enough. I caught this out of the corner of my eye, and I was on this really, really dangerous, windy road, and I just did something really stupid. I just cranked the wheel really quickly and ran out of the car, and this, you know, just, it was like, boom, shot it, gone. This is just before, you know, the crops have just been planted. And so you still see the brown, the dirt coming through. That's a nice little touch. This is the opposite end of the year. This is after the crops have been picked, and now they're tilling the soil, getting it ready for the winter. A little duck photography. Sitting on the side of the road, trying to decide what to do, shooting out my window. I thought this looked really cool, and a lot of people comment on this. I like it, but it got a huge response. I send out a weekly email blast to people that are on my list, and I was surprised at how many people commented on it. Fog is a great thing to shoot in. It gives you a very ethereal look, very 3D. It really changes the lighting. This I shot about 4 weeks ago. I was in White Sands, New Mexico, shooting the dunes. This is, again, right at the end of the day. I looked off in the distance and a sandstorm was coming towards me. And luckily for me, there was just enough light that it was lighting the back of the sand blowing. You have very dramatic shadows out there, always changing. But it's always a very small time frame. It's like sitting around for a good part of the day, then about, you know, 1 or 2 o'clock, get all my equipment on me, head out into the desert, you know, go 2 hours out into the desert, frantically look for a bunch of different positions to shoot from. And the actual shooting time that you get is probably, I don't know, 15, 20 minutes, and then get to walk back in the dark or the almost dark. This is after the sun has gone completely down. It's an odd effect that happened here. Again, just at the very end of the day, extremely strong wind, and what's happening is the wind is blowing just the surface of the dunes, and it's making the dunes look like they're moving. They have a silky look to them. Even though the picture is sharp, it looks like it's been softened on the highlights. Obviously, White Sands, New Mexico. Great place to shoot. Very bad for your eyes. It's very hard to shoot in a place like this with sunglasses on and then take your sunglasses off and shoot. So what you end up doing is not wearing sunglasses, and a couple days here will really make you see things when you go to bed at night, when you close your eyes, and it's just there's all kinds of flashes happening and bizarre things floating in front of you, which probably not that great. I love the graphic quality of this. This fence just totally buried in the dune. I'll tell you that this, the interesting thing about this picture is that it's not Photoshop. Pahrump, Nevada. I think that's how you pronounce it. Pahrump. Yeah. Each early spring, as the snow melts in the mountains, puts a very thin film of water over the Bonneville Salt Flats. This is where they do the land speed records. In a couple weeks, this will all be as hard as could be. It'll be like concrete, white concrete, but for a very short period of time, it puts this thin film of water over the salt flats, and you get a great reflection here. This is a really fun place to shoot. You can just pull right off the highway, get on the salt flats, just floor the car and just drive for just endlessly. It just never ends. Just keep going, driving in any direction. Very late in the year, snowstorm in Yellowstone. And again, just a lucky shot, just happened to be shooting something else. For 10 seconds, a skim of light just comes across the top of the mountain. An ongoing project, which is, I love shooting in junkyards. I spent all of April out west where I had arrangements with all these vintage junkyards to visit them and to shoot. I'm not necessarily looking to photograph junk cars, although I do sometimes photograph junk cars. I'm just looking for the shapes and the details on the cars. I went to this place, and then this was actually done a couple years ago. And I'm sitting watching TV one night, and I'm watching TV, and I see this guy, and I'm like, "Where do I know him from?" and I realized it was that show Desert Car Kings, and I had been there, and then they I don't know, somehow they got the idea to make a reality show out of their business. So the rear window, you can see the heating elements. So I'm exposing for the window, bringing down the color temperature on the camera, so it's bluing it a little bit. And then because I'm exposing for out here, the inside of the car just went dead black and it created this very graphic look. What can you say, Roadrunner? This I thought looked like a stampede. I called it paint layer stampede. So it looked, apparently somebody took a grinding wheel or some kind of device like that and trying to grind the paint off the side of the car, and it gave this effect. I did a whole series of these of just the inside of trunk lids on old cars, 1950s cars. I would open them up, stand them up straight so all the lines were parallel. It almost looks like it was underwater. The window was tinted so heavily. Somebody at some point put one of these extremely heavy tints on it, I guess because it was out in the southwest, and it almost made the bottom half of the picture look like it was underwater. This is a very little town out in the Nevada desert where, I guess, out of boredom, people would just take all their junk cars and do things like just like bury them upright in the sand, stack them like 10 high. For what reason, I don't know. Boredom, I guess. I have some shots here from Hawaii. I call that Hawaii is always interesting because there's so many graphic shapes in Hawaii. Of course, I do shoot usual kind of landscapes and things like that, but I'm always looking for some odd way to shoot the usual thing. Here I was photographing flowers, floating them in an aquarium in my studio out there, letting them sink and then letting the water settle. So you see the edge of the water's edge. The Honolulu Fish Market. This is a shot from a helicopter on the one side of my island, Kauai, which is not accessible. It's only accessible by boat from the ocean or if you fly over it in a helicopter. On the big island of Hawaii, you can drive up to Mauna Kea. It's where all the satellites are. The deep space telescopes are up there. Very dramatic lighting, very dramatic conditions. You start out the trip at the bottom in a bathing suit, and by the time you get up here, I always bring ski clothing, gloves and hat and everything. It's brutal up here, usually like a 40 mile an hour wind. Sometimes it's hard to even get out of the car to push the door open. But here I'm taking advantage of the top of the mountain being so dead black, and I'm just exposing for the railing and letting everything else just fade away. And when you get up to the top, which is I think about 15,000 feet, this is what you get to see. So you're up above the clouds, which is almost like being in a jet, but being outside the jet. So this is Maui off in the distance, and here's the edge of the big island. It's very impressive, very uncomfortable to shoot up there. I'm gonna have to let you guys start asking questions soon so you don't get restless. It's a panoramic near my home. Here on the island of Lanai, they planted all of these Norfolk pines to gather the ocean mist that comes in and collect the rainwater from them. There's hundreds of thousands of these trees planted on both sides of every road. Everywhere you go, there's just everywhere you go, there's these trees. And I was trying to show the graphic nature of that, so I shot it, duped it, flipped it, and then butted them together. Just to give us the reflection, appearance of a reflection. Also on my island, this is a great American success story. The dirt is so red that basically, if you get it on your clothing, you might as well just throw your clothing away. Well, it didn't take long for somebody to figure out that they could take a washing machine, put t-shirts in it, and dirt, and then just run the washing machine. And they start, this is a multi-million dollar business. Nobody comes to Kauai and doesn't buy a Red Dirt t-shirt. And that's the name of this guy's company, is Red Dirt Shirts. And that is basically all he is doing. I mean, if you go to their warehouse where they work, it's just a bunch of washing machines, and that's all they're doing is just throwing the dirt in there. And that kind of ties in with this. This horse, his mane is white, or I should say his mane was white, and this is what's happened to him living there. It's just so dirty that there's no chance, that you could ever clean them. This guy I found one morning fishing, and I was just like, now this is just perfect. I got a local guy fishing, and it's so serene, and the reflection in this tidal pool where he's shooting, and I said, this just says everything about the Hawaiian people and the serenity of it and everything. And when he was done, I introduced myself, and he said, I'm from New Jersey. I was standing on my balcony, looking down at the pool in my hotel, and got this scene of this kid floating on his back. This is just has a funny story attached to it. The water here is about 12 inches deep. And I don't know, I mean, I didn't even want to watch this guy do this. He would just jump off and just run back in, run across the beach, come down behind me and get on the pier and just jump off again. And, you see people do it in the circus. I guess he was just flattening out like at the last second before he hit, so. On my island, I don't own the island, but on Kauai, there's a very bizarre place called Glass Beach, where for some reason the local people take their cars, their junk, glass bottles, everything, and they just push it off a cliff down into the water. And they've been doing that for God knows how long, to the point where if you stand on the beach and you look back up on the cliff, the entire side of the cliff embedded in it is just the last 100 years of bottles and transmissions and all kinds of things like this. These are all engines. There's a crankshaft, a whole engine block with the crankshaft. That's a whole engine, that's a whole engine. So I started going here. And first I started just shooting these kind of scenes of dragging out the exposure, letting the water swirl around. This is an engine, obviously. It's been there for so long that it's just... Now, the other side of this is you could say that maybe this isn't so stupid because, I mean, anything that's on the Earth is made from stuff from the Earth, so this is basically returning to the Earth. I mean, it's just, breaking down, and it's just returning back to where it came from. One of the things that takes the longest are spark plugs, which is what these are. You can see so many bottles have been thrown off the cliff and into this water there that this is the sand. This is just how the sand looks. It's just the 50 or 60% of the sand is bottles and just little fragments of stuff. But because these spark plugs are ceramic, I guess, they just take forever to disappear. This I thought was very interesting. This is a whole engine and a transmission. It almost looks like some kind of mechanical salmon trying to swim upstream. And this is a little tidal pool. So conservatively, this is a truck engine and a truck transmission. I'm sure it weighs 500-600 pounds, maybe more. Almost every day when I would return, it would be in a different place. So it just shows you like the power of the ocean. Sometimes I think to myself, I look at sand and I say, how could sand be made out of seashells? Like how much power could there be in the ocean? But I would come back like the next day and this thing would be 20 feet away. So during the night, you know, it's just like when the tide came in and stuff. So I started trying to find unusual looking pieces there. And I would go every day and I would bring a background with me and my tripod with a big boom so I could shoot straight down on stuff. And I started doing these still life shots. This is a clutch plate of everything I found there. Eventually, I got tired of doing that, so I would just collect, after I photographed all the big stuff I needed to shoot, I started bringing the stuff back to my studio in my garage back at the house and setting up the same situation and just photographing the pieces. This is a crankshaft. This is what's left of a differential. That's that big thing in the back underneath the rear wheels there, back by the rear wheels. This is a spark plug totally encased in just coral and melted glass and rust and all the other junk that fused to it. I call that starter motor. There's a tractor rear end. Wheel. The last two portfolios I had to show you, then you can either ask me questions or not ask me questions. It's very rare that I work in black and white, but that doesn't really mean anything anymore because you shoot color, then you can just make it black and white. And I flip-flop back and forth with this portfolio. I found a really great antique store up in the Adirondacks with a guy that is totally dedicated to all this antique fishing memorabilia. And he gave me complete access to the collection and let me shoot. I went up there and lived up there and photographed all this stuff that came from like the turn of the century and the early part of this century. And the more I looked at the stuff back and forth, you know, some days I like it in color, some days I like it in black and white, but I thought in honor of Mel DiGiacomo that I would show you these next two portfolios in black and white because Mel always teases me and he tells me that whenever I send him like a black and white picture like this, he tells me, now I'm finally starting to shoot something. So, or he takes his latest quote, he told me, was, there's only two colors in photography, black and white. So, there was a time when a lot of these craftsmen left Europe and they came to America in the 20s and 30s. This actually, I didn't want to throw a color one in amongst all these, but this is really something to see. I call it the hieroglyphics reel, but this is all hand carved. Beautiful, you know, you would say to yourself, why would you even take this outside on a boat? Like, you know, you could potentially drop it, but there is such an art to all of these antique reels and these lures. The other amazing thing is what used to be you know, these outboard motors, which in the world we live in today, where, you know, you're so protected with everything, everything is so safe and mechanical things are so shielded and everything. Here's the spark plug, which would knock you right out of the boat. Here's the wire that's fully exposed. Here's the gas thing right above it with the filler cap. Here's the starter, that's how you pull start it with a rope that you wrapped around it. There's no prop guard or anything like that. Same thing here. It's just these are the fuel lines and vents, and there's just kind of hoses sitting next to like the spark plugs. But I think these translate well into black and white. And then The last portfolio, in honor of Mel, is this is from my shooting that I just did in April out in the West. Hoodoos, Dunes, and Salt. So these are some very unique locations that I travel to out there. A hoodoo is this thing where there's one kind of dirt present with another form of rock on top of it. I guess through erosion, the bottom stuff goes away faster than the top stuff, and you're left with these shapes. This is this fantastic valley and canyons that I was able to wander to. It was probably about 2 hours of driving on dirt roads from the nearest highway, and then that highway was about an hour from the nearest town. Dunes. This is a panoramic of the Bonneville Salt Flat. This is what it looks like in its dry stage as compared to the picture I showed you before when it had water sitting on it. While I was shooting the dunes, I turned around and this is what was behind me. So that was a double-sided photo event there, shooting the dunes one way and then this storm coming out behind me. This is a black and white version of the scene I showed you before with the approaching sandstorm. The sunset on the salt flats. Sunrise. I'm looking at this as sunrise, not sunset. Again, the wind blowing the dunes and giving it that very silky look to it. Not the best thing for the camera. This is Death Valley. White sands. And I think that's it. Thank you.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.